All right, thanks for the introduction, Bobby. It's great to be here today and tell you about my new work on persuasion networks. At a high level, this paper will be about information design for network systems. And in this talk, I'll think about a model where agents correspond to nodes in a social network. They take binary actions, and the actions of agents exhibit local strategic complementarities. So in particular, I'll focus on a payoff structure. My tail from taking action 1 is higher if my friends in the underlying network also take action 1. These GIJs are just entries of the underlying unweighted adjacency matrix. And the tails are higher if I benefit from network externalities. And also there is a state of the world that's payoff relevant. High state translates into a higher tail. Now, in the absence of any information about the underlying state, agents will just take actions to maximize their expected payoffs, but maybe it is possible to design information taking into account the underlying network structure to influence agents' actions, and in particular, do it in a way that maximizes the total expected activity. That is what I'll be thinking about in this paper, and I'll be more concrete with the model later on.
But now I'm switching mics. If you want to think about an application, the talk will be set in an abstract setting, but if you want to think about an application, you can think about the following setting. We have a seller who is offering a product that exhibits local network externalities. I have higher payoff from using this product if my friends in the underlying network use the same product. The quality is a priori unknown, and one can send informative signals about the quality of the product, and how to do that in a way that maximizes the sales. That will be the type of question that this model will answer. In a nutshell, here are the contributions of the paper. I first show that for any given network, it is possible to characterize the optimal mechanism in terms of the cores of the underlying network. K-core of a graph is the maximal induced subgraph where each node has degree at least K. So think about just groups of tightly connected agents, if you will. Under the optimal mechanism, the set of possible signal realizations correspond to the cores of the underlying graph, and the mechanism is incentive compatible in the sense that when the signal realization is K, the agents in the K core find it optimal to take action 1. So this will be the general structure. Of course, this structure on its own doesn't tell us what the optimal mechanism should look like. That is the second contribution. I show that optimal mechanism always associates at most two subintervals of the set of states with each core of the graph. And I provide a convex programming formulation plus an algorithm to construct the optimal mechanism. This structure is interesting because of the following. The set of states for which an agent takes action 1 will indeed be a non-convex subset of all set of states. In information design or Bayesian persuasion, you usually have, let's say, threshold type of mechanisms, which say that if the state is higher than the threshold, agents take one action, otherwise they take the other action. So the set of states for which the agents take one action is usually a convex subset of set of all states. That's not going to be the case here. And there will be some interesting and non-trivial structure. Here is what I am not going to talk about today. It is in the paper, and I'm very excited about this, and I'm happy to tell you about it offline as well. For the talk, I'm stick to a setting where I know the network, but in the paper, I explore a setting where I know just the degree distribution of the network, but we will have a large number of nodes in the underlying network. It turns out that for large random networks, you can characterize, asymptotically, you can characterize the size of the core, and by using just this information, by just the degree distribution, it is also possible to construct asymptotically optimal mechanisms that maximize the objective that I mentioned earlier. I'm happy to tell you about this offline. Now, more details about the model. Given a network with an unweighted adjacency matrix, in the paper I take care of the weighted scenario as well. Nothing really changes, but this is for simplicity. State of the world is distributed according to a known distribution. One assumption that I'm going to exploit is this one. The set of possible state realizations will be a subinterval of the reals. The random variable t, the state, is going to be absolutely continuous, and the CDF will be strictly increasing on the domain. And as I mentioned earlier, this is the payoff structure that I'm going to focus on in today's work. In the paper, I explore other settings where we have a general supermodular function of AIs and A minus size, but simpler setting is what I'll focus on here. So, in the absence of any information about the state T, agents will take actions that maximize their expected payoffs. But let's suppose that agent I had access to some random variable that's correlated with the state, some signal that's informative about the underlying state. Then the agent would update her posterior about the state and would possibly take different actions. We won't be thinking about a signal that is available arbitrarily there, but we'll think about the design question. An information designer chooses an information structure. An information designer chooses the signal or the mechanism that shares these signals with the agents in the network to influence their behavior. Agents observe the signal, update their posterior, and then at the induced equilibrium, our objective is to maximize the total expected activity. Now, if you are familiar with the Bayesian persuasion literature, I'll make the common commitment assumption. So the information designer commits to the mechanism, commits to a public signaling mechanism that shares an informative signal S with all the agents. All agents observe the same signal. In that sense, the mechanism is public. And I commit to the mechanism before the state is realized. Then once the state is realized, I share the signals with the agents according to the mechanism that I have specified in the first place. And you can think about the mechanism as a mapping from the state to different signals. All right, so is the setting clear? Any questions about the setting? Right? All right. So the interaction among the agents, given the information structure, can be analyzed at the Bayes-Nash equilibrium of the corresponding game. The problem is there might be multiple equilibria. If that is the case, I'll break ties in favor of the equilibrium that is most beneficial to the information designer or the sender. In other words, I'll focus on the sender preferred equilibrium. With slight tweaks of the model, the results generalize to the worst equilibrium as well. Happy to tell you about this offline as well. Now, this is the equilibrium where the largest number of agents will take action one. So think about an arbitrary mechanism. What is the largest set of agents who take action one in this mechanism? How can we think about that before we get to designing the mechanism? Suppose that I give you a signal realization little s. Given that I'm focusing on public signals, all agents do the same updates about the state. They all have the same posterior about the state. And given the realization of the signal, they basically play a game with these payoffs. It is immediate that this is a game with a supermodular payoff structure. It has a largest equilibrium and the smallest equilibrium. The largest equilibrium is going to characterize the sender preferred equilibrium of my game, basically. More formally, at the sender preferred equilibrium of the persuasion game that I'm posing, given any signal realization, a maximal set of agents who have more than this many connections within the set will find it optimal to take action one. This is a mouthful. Just think about the following. Suppose that the realization of the signal is such that the expectation of the state conditional on the signal is minus 5. If there's a group of agents where each member of the group has connections to 5 other agents within the group, if all these agents take action one, network externalities outweigh the disutility due to the state, so these agents find it optimal to take action one. Largest such sets will be the set of agents who find it optimal to take action one at the standard preferred equilibrium. The thing is, this object is actually something that we know from graph theory. This is exactly the k-core of the underlying network, where k is given by this minus the conditional expectation. If you're unfamiliar with this, zero core is the set of all nodes. One core is obtained from the zero core by removing all nodes who have degree zero. Two core is obtained from the one core, iteratively removing nodes who have degree one. Three core is the darkest region here, and so on and so forth. It is different. K core is different than the set of agents who have degree greater than K. A line network, all nodes are in the one core, no node is in the two core, but it is not a difficult object to characterize or reason about. Now, what I have done so far is to just establish that at the standard preferred equilibrium, the set of agents who take action one will correspond to a core of the underlying network. I can actually exploit the structure when it comes to designing the optimal mechanism. Just think about the following. Take any public signaling mechanism pi. And in this mechanism, there will be a set of signal realizations that induce the k-core to take action 1. Define a new mechanism, pi prime, which sends signal k whenever the other mechanism sends one of these signals that induce the k-core to take action 1. In the new mechanism, pi prime, whenever the realization of the signal is k, agents will find it optimal to take action k, given that this is the k, this is the case under mechanism pi. This is just saying that given any mechanism, I can construct an equivalent mechanism where the possible signal realizations correspond to the different cores of the underlying network, and when the mechanism sends signal k, agents in the k core find it optimal to take action 1. So, given that this is true for any mechanism, it's true for the optimal one as well. There exists an optimal mechanism that is simple. By simple, I mean each signal realization corresponds to a k-core of the graph, and it's incentive compatible in the sense that when the signal realization is k, agents in the k-core find it optimal to take action 1. And this is just a version of the revelation principle, if you will. I am saying that it is optimal to publicly recommend a group of agents who take an action, and you want to design the incentives to ensure that agents actually follow this public recommendation. Right? Okay. Now I'm going to exploit this structure to simplify our problem a little bit, and I'm going to pose an equivalent partitioning problem. So I know that there is an optimal mechanism that's a simple mechanism, and I would like to search over simple mechanisms. Suppose that I characterize the cores of my graph from 0 to d. I still need to do the following. Take the set of possible state realizations, t. I need to partition it such that when the realization of the state is in the kth partition element, let's say the red element, I send signal k that induces the k-core to take action 1. And with each core, I basically associate a partition element, let's say red with the 1 core, blue with the 2 core, and so on and so forth. In order to figure out the optimal mechanism, I need to figure out the optimal way of partitioning the set of all state set of all possible state realizations, and I can express this problem as in here. I'm optimizing over partitions such that when the realization of the state is in the kth partition element, I send signal k, the k core takes action 1, and this induces a reward of rk, which is the cardinality of the k core. This is the total number of people who will take action 1 under this signal. And I would like to choose my partitions in a way that ensures this constraint. This is just my incentive compatibility constraint. This constraint is just ensuring that when the signal is k, agents in the k core find it optimal to take action 1 indeed. But here's the problem. There's a fundamental difficulty here because now I am trying to optimize over all the partitions, and it's a pretty messy set, and it's not clear how to search over these partitions to figure out the optimal mechanism. And I'll try to basically, you know, address this difficulty following a two-step approach. The first step is, as opposed to solving this problem directly, I'm going to work with a convex relaxation of this problem. And second, given the solution to the convex relaxation of this problem, I'm going to reverse engineer a partition and an optimal public signaling mechanism. That's where we are going. In more detail, suppose that I give you a simple mechanism pi. I am going to associate two sets of numbers with this mechanism, pk's, a sequence of numbers, pk's and zk's. Pk captures the probability with which this mechanism sends signal k, and zk is defined as in here. It's easier to think about zk divided by pk. Zk divided by pk is the conditional expectation signal k induces for this mechanism. Now, in a simple mechanism, I have these pk's and zk satisfy my incentive compatibility constraint. Remember, zk over pk captures the conditional expectation and my requirement that it should be greater than minus k. This is this constraint. And by exploiting some elementary properties of conditional expectations, I also have an identity like this one. On the left, I have some of these expectations. On the right, I have this term that looks somewhat funky, but it is really the expectation that you can evaluate by shifting all the probability mass here to the right hand of the support. It's fairly basic algebra. I'm happy to tell you more about this offline, but nothing really deep going on there. But the point is, given a simple mechanism, the associated pk's and zk's will satisfy these constraints, and furthermore, the induced activity under this mechanism will be given as in here. With probability pk, the k-core is activated. I get a reward of rk. Sum this over all k, you have the total expected activity. key idea, as opposed to optimizing over partitions, I'll go ahead and optimize over PKs and ZKs, the two sets of numbers associated with the simple mechanisms. I'm going to impose these constraints that any simple mechanism satisfies, and I'll maximize this objective. And because of what I mentioned in the previous slide, any simple mechanism will induce a feasible solution to this problem, but not vice versa. There are feasible solutions that are not consistent with any simple mechanism. I will solve this problem, and then I'll try to reverse engineer a mechanism that's consistent with the optimal solution. By that, what I mean is the following. I would like to construct a mechanism which indeed sends signal k with probability p star k obtained from the optimal solution, and the conditional expectation under this mechanism is going to be zk star or pk star, consistent with what I was outlining in the previous slide. And the somewhat interesting thing is that this is always doable, this relaxation is tight, and we provide an algorithm to construct this mechanism pi star. So I don't have time to go to the details of this, but let me try to at least sketch what's going on here. This is my optimization problem, and the construction really works with the optimality conditions of this problem. In particular, there will be a sequence of index sets L1 through Lm for which this constraint is binding. The first key lemma says that any two index sets for which this constraint is binding is going to be different by at most two elements. The cardinality of their difference is at most two. Let Li bar be that difference. Take the optimal solution of my optimization problem. This is the relaxation. Take the set of possible state realizations and associate the rightmost interval of this set of states with L1 bar, the next one with L2 bar, next one with L3 bar, and so on and so forth. And choose the widths of these intervals such that the interval associated with Li bar is exactly equal in size to sum of pk star k that belong to Li bar. So I'm choosing these intervals consistently with what my optimization problem predicts. There are two cases. Either Li bar is a singleton, in which case this is the interval associated with Li bar. After some algebra by working out optimality conditions, it follows that this construction ensures that z star divided by p star for my optimization formulation is equal to the conditional expectation I get when the realization of the state is in the corresponding interval. If it consists of two different elements, then I do the following thought experiment. If you take the leftmost side of the interval and associate it with one of the elements that belong to Li bar, so if you associate the leftmost chunk of this interval with K1, then you undershoot the target conditional expectation. Right-hand side, you overshoot it. If you move some probability mass from left to right, you can match the target conditional expectation. And by just following this approach, I obtain somewhat of a messy algorithm. So I'm going to hide this. It just does what I described. Here's a prettier picture. And this behavior is actually generic. What happens in the optimal mechanism is that you take the set of possible state realizations, you have different cores of this graph, and you partition the set of states such that with each core you associate up to two different intervals. And in this optimal mechanism that I construct using the optimization formulation and the algorithm, I have the double interval structure, and it's always the case that it is in general the case that with agents, an agent is active for some non-convex subset of possible state realizations. I think I am out of time. I'll stop here. I think going forward, it's interesting to explore the intersection of networks and information design. Thank you.